So let's talk about the difference between this scope with the little dollar sign right there, and this scope, which is in a linking function, which doesn't have a dollar sign. So if you look at our HTML, you can see we have a controller and then a directive inside of it. And if we log this out, you can see I'm doing console log on both that and that scope. You can see it's the exact same scope, same ID and everything. It's just the exact same thing. As we've mentioned before, if you isolate it by giving it its own scope, then it'll create a new scope for that. So you can see 4 and 3, so they're different. That's not really the topic we're going to go into here. We're actually going to discuss why these are different, why they're named differently. So if we'll start right here, you've probably seen scope, element, element attributes, and you've always seen them in that order. So if I were to do something like put the element, or let's do this first. So if I were to log out the element, we'll comment this out. If I log out the element, you can see it's logging out the element for obvious reasons. Now if I change the order of this so that element comes first and scope comes second, you can see that we're back to getting the scope. That means that this is not the element. This is the scope. Because the order here is important, it doesn't matter what I name this. I can name this whatever, APU, and I refresh, and I still get that scope. You can see I named this scope, and I can even name it dollar scope, even though this kind of goes against convention. But that's still going to give us a scope because the naming does not matter. What matters here is the order. The reason being that this is just a method that's being called with those specific things as the arguments. With a scope, element, no matter what these are named, even though it's dollar scope, scope, attributes, scope, element, attributes, doesn't matter what you name them. So this is completely different from, and with good reason, from what's going on up here. So let's comment this out. So if I pass in the scope, let's make sure it's working. So we got the same scope. If I pass in the scope and I change the name of this to just scop and I try and log out scop, you'll see that we get an error instead because there's no such thing as a scop provider. That's because these guys that are passed into things like a controller or a service, those are all dependent on the providers that are available. So there's things like an HTTP provider, a parse provider, and other things that have been predefined. So if I log HTTP here, you can see it's going to show me exactly what that HTTP function is. If I change the order and I put HTTP first and put scope second, I'm still going to get HTTP because the order does not matter. What matters here is the name, because what it's doing is it's taking the name of whatever you pass in and then trying to find a provider for this. This is using dependency injection to do a lookup based on the name to find a provider to satisfy its dependencies. So if you look at this a little bit differently, this is actually kind of a shorthand. The longer version of what's going on here, I'm just going to kind of delete all of this. The longer version of what's going on here is we can pass in an array as the second and as the second value here, and the we can set up the dependency injection this way by saying we want the scope there. And then the last value in the array can be the function. And then I can name the scope whatever I want. So I'll just name it scope for now. I'll do console log scope. And then I get the scope again when I log it out. Now, because I did it this way instead, and you can do things like the service and the factory and other guys this exact same way. If I do it this way instead, this is what's going to protect against minification, because when you minify things, it'll rename things like scope to A. So if I call this A, I'm still going to get the scope because I'm looking up by name using this string here, and the string's not going to get minified. It's looking up the scope provider and then passing it as the first argument. So this is kind of the longhand way of doing it, but it's what protects against minification when you run it through the minifiers that are out there. Now, it's much more convenient to do the shorthand way, and there are tools being built to help generate this longhand way for you. But for right now, if you are worried about minification, it's pretty well covered in the docs. But just to kind of show what else is going on here, if I were to pass in HTTP and then just call this B, if I log out A, I'll still get the scope. If I log out B, I'll get HTTP. And now if I change the order, I'll get the scope again, because now the order is important because I define the order here. Now, this may be a little bit confusing if you're not used to the concept of dependency injection, of looking up providers, using an injector to satisfy dependencies, because what's going on is it's looking up what it needs to fulfill this and then passing it in. It has absolutely nothing to do with how this is being called, where it's just simply calling a method and then passing in arguments 1, 2, and 3. This is a completely separate process of looking up dependencies and then passing them in based on the name. So hopefully that clears it up a little bit. And while some people may think this is inconsistent, it's actually, if you look at how this is done here, if you want to inject something into your directive, you would similarly say HTTP here, or parse, or some of the other providers. Actually, if I look at the AngularJS source, and I look at, you just search for provide.provider, you can see a list of the things that you can inject that are provided by AngularJS itself. So log, parse, route, root scope, the queue, sniffer, things like that. Or some of the services that you define yourself, you can inject those as well. And those have nothing to do with this link function. This link function is just the scope that's available for the component you're working on, the element, which is, you know, the element that the tag and attributes that you're working on inside of your directive, which is completely separate from the providers used in AngularJS for things like filtering and interpolating and making HTTP requests. So hopefully that clarifies a bit what's going on, how these are completely different, and why the naming is important here. They use a dollar sign just to kind of say this is an Angular thing. If you look in here, they're all prefaced with dollar signs. And then in here, they're Angular things that are injected. And then in here, the naming doesn't really matter. It's just scope, element, attribute, because that's the best name for those things. So that's scope versus scope. Hopefully that clears it up. Again, you can use things like apps service and use the same syntax for defining the name and then injecting things. App factory, or a lot of the other things when configuring your module. And then this always has to be the same. You can't change what the order of these are. Anyway, I think I've repeated that enough times. Hopefully that'll stick, and good luck.